Welcome to Lawton Online with your host, Andrew Lawton. He's locked, loaded, and ready to fire. Lawton Online starts right now.
Hello and welcome to you. My name's Andrew Lawton, and this is Lawton Online here on TheRebel.media. We've got a great show up ahead for you today. Given the timing of the show, however, I wanted to make this the Canada Day edition of the show. I know I'm actually recording it on Canada Day. I know by the time you hear it, it's actually going to be the day after. But I think the sentiments still stand. Because there are a number of issues I wanted to touch on that really follow along this vein. The first is perhaps inconsequential in the grand scheme of things, although that's not historically how it's always been, and that's the actual name of the day. It's not Canada Day to me, it's Dominion Day, and I'm assuming to most of you it's very similar, where this day was, to be honest, tarnished by an illegal and hasty vote in 1982 that forever changed the course of history and actually was itself an act of revisionist history. It's interesting, the death of Dominion Day took place in 1982, on July 9th, a little over a week after what was then Dominion Day. It was 4 o'clock on a Friday afternoon. Now, anyone who's ever worked in Ottawa or observed Ottawa can tell you that on a Friday, there is no one there. The House of Commons is a ghost town on Fridays. The only MPs that are there are the ones who are obliged to because of what's known as house duty, typically. There were 13 MPs in the 282-seat chamber. It was the weekend. Summer recess was approaching. And they were dealing with private members' bill. The least interesting aspect of what happens in Parliament. And one MP, several months prior, a Quebec Liberal MP had introduced an act to amend the Holidays Act. This was a bill that would propose the change of name from Dominion Day to Canada Day. Anytime this issue had come up in the past, according to the Ottawa Citizen, it had been pushed away by most mainstream MPs from many different parties. The bill was called up by the Deputy Speaker. There was a belief by him that it had unanimous consent. Debate on the matter lasted 3 minutes long. House of Commons didn't even have quorum at the moment, so technically the vote wasn't even legal. 20 MPs required to be in the House to conduct business. The Speaker said that since no one called a quorum count, a quorum was deemed to exist. This only came up after the fact, because even the Speaker wasn't in the chamber. But forever, because of that day, the holiday is known as Canada Day. To most generations from here on in and outward, Dominion Day never existed. And that in and of itself is concerning, because even if we've changed the name, getting rid of the history attached to the word Dominion was shameful. It was not a word that denoted subservience to Great Britain. It was a word that denoted a relationship with God. And maybe that was why people found it so offensive. It came from Sir Leonard Tilley, a man from New Brunswick, one of the delegates of the provinces of Canada, who attended a conference in England in 1866 to discuss the matter of Confederation. Originally, they wanted to call Canada the Kingdom of Canada, but it was thought that that would make it perhaps too concerning to the Republican neighbors to the south. So what happened was Tilley, when reading his Bible, saw in the 72nd Psalm the verse, "He shall have dominion also from sea to sea and from the river unto the ends of the earth." And that's exactly what was wanted for Canada, a country that would spread from sea to sea to sea. The Queen was sold on the word Dominion. The British North America Act set out those very terms. But now it's seen as being too British. It's seen as being too colonialistic. But there's nothing British about the word, as also noted by David Menzies in a piece he wrote for the National Post in 2006, and also in an Ottawa Citizen piece about the subject. Because no, what's actually at the root of it is a Hebrew word that means to let rule. And I think that this speaks to a lot of the issues facing Canada. You say what's in a name? Well, quite a bit, to be perfectly frank. It's not that I feel Canada is defined now by not being a dominion. It's not that I feel that inherently is the point of concern. But rather, it's this banal subservience to political correctness, to needless change, to window dressing that is the problem with Canada. You know, political scientist Dr. William Gairdner has written about this, the trouble with Canada, and then more recently, the trouble with Canada still. And he talks a lot about the social issues, which, yes, do create a part of the picture of what is wrong with Canada in many ways. And I don't want anyone to mistake that for a statement that I dislike Canada. As a matter of fact, it's quite the contrary. I like Canada. I love Canada. That's why it bothers me when I see so many inadequacies in the way we view ourselves from a national identity perspective and the way that our country operates politically and based on our laws. You know, I spoke, I think it was on my second or third show of, or this podcast anyway, about the question of Canadian exceptionalism, which was a question that people were asking just a couple of months ago. And it came down to a discussion of whether or not a belief that your country is superior is a valid thought. And what was so concerning was how many Canadians thought that was offensive. How many Canadians thought it was rude or inappropriate or politically incorrect to have a sense of absolute pride in your country, the likes of which are falling under that banner of national exceptionalism in any form. You'll remember Barack Obama once saying, well, he believes in American exceptionalism only the way the Greeks believe in Greek exceptionalism or the Brits believe in British exceptionalism. And excellence and exceptionalism are not relative concepts. You either are or aren't. That's like saying that there's such a thing as Iranian exceptionalism. Well, they may think there is, but objectively, there's not. So what do we do as Canadians? Who are we as Canadians? And this is a very, very sticky point for me, because when I've spoken to people about this, not people inside the bubble of my own political or religious views, but you know what, the lesser intelligent folks. No, I'm joking, of course, but people who are just the average Canadian. And I remember doing this several years ago, talking to random people on the street. Are you proud to be Canadian? Everyone said, absolutely yes. Ask why. I'll be damned if I didn't get several dozen survey questions that I posed to, the questions that I posed to several dozen people, rather. I'll be damned if only a couple were not something that had to do with hockey or healthcare or not being American. Canada has allowed itself, and Canadians have allowed themselves, to define this nation by not being something else rather than by actually being something. And I don't know what the answer to that is, because our country has gone through such extraordinary lengths to avoid having any sort of identity, to avoid having anything that is quintessentially Canadian. You know, I don't watch beauty pageants. Every now and then I'll see clips from them or pictures. And I remember a couple of years ago, during, I think it was Miss Universe, every year, every time they do this contest, this pageant, the contestants, who represent a variety of countries from around the world, obviously, have to wear clothing that is from their country. And every now and then you'll get, like, Miss Japan wearing a geisha costume, and you'll get, you know, Miss USA, I've seen them wearing an eagle costume. You'll get, you know, Miss China wearing some traditional Chinese regalia. You'll have people from the South Pacific wearing clothes that are typical to that region. And I remember one year, and they've done it a few years. Look up Miss Canada, and I'm sure, or Miss Canada and Miss Universe pageant, and you'll find this. Miss Canada wearing a giant maple leaf. Miss Canada wearing basically the Canadian flag, because we don't have anything in the country that apparently is that unique that, unless she shows up dressed as a giant beaver, of course, which may send the wrong message for Miss Universe, I would assume, then we really don't have that much that makes us unique. What is Canadian cuisine? We got poutine. That's about it. And don't get me wrong. I like poutine. But a country has to mean more than that. And I look at our neighbors to the south. I look at the U.S. as an example of what happens when a country loses its way. Because that's what the U.S. is in the midst of. Mark Stein has written about this. Most conservative authors have woken up to this. And it's concerning, to say the least. This is a country who did, for generations, believe in American exceptionalism. A country who established its identity based on the values of freedom, based on the values of liberty, based on the values of independence. A country whose founding document, the Declaration of Independence, has still to this day become enshrined in that country's identity. But they've lost it. From Obama, the president of the country, who's been one of the most concerningly anti-American presidents. Doesn't mean that he hates the country, but anti-American in terms of what American has meant for so long. Bowing to Saudi kings. Moving forward with policies that further dilute what it is to be American. And I'm not an American. I don't have that emotional attachment to the American flag, to the Declaration of Independence. But I know people that do. I've witnessed it. I've seen it. And even just objectively, as an observer, as someone who's traveled to the U.S., who works in the U.S. sometimes, who has interacted with people and does on a regular basis from the U.S., I see the significance of that. And I see the embarrassment almost at how much it has been diluted. You know, I was on the Blaze TV last week, Glenn Beck's television channel, with my friend Kira Davis, and she was guest hosting for Dana Lash. And Kira was chatting with me, and I made a joke at the start of the segment, which, based on emails I got, is unfortunately not that funny for some people, because it's true for them. You see, she had Gavin McInnes on, fellow rebel, and the next day myself was on, and Kira herself was born in Canada, so she was joking about all the Canadians, and I had said, just in passing, I said, well, you know, to be honest with our government right now, I'm pretty sure we can be more of an authority on conservatism than you can. And she laughed, she found it funny. No one, I don't think, was offended by it. But I got emails from people that night saying, oh my goodness, you're absolutely right. And to be clear, that's not an original concept. Other people have noted that before. But I think it speaks to one of the biggest problems, that we are now in a place that would have 20 years ago been unprecedented, that would have 30 years ago, during the age of Ronald Reagan, been unprecedented, which is an unforeseen, which was that Canada would somehow become more of a global leader in the fight for freedom, a global leader in the right for true human rights, not the hallmark human rights, a global leader in the fight for economic liberty as well, than the United States. Even when we look back through history and look at when the U.S. has had its left-leaning presidents, there still has been an element of them holding on to this idea of Americanism, of American exceptionalism. And I know I'm talking a lot about the United States of America in the Canada Day show, but I think it's so relevant because we actually have the opportunity to fix our problems. We actually have the opportunity to move towards having an identity that does not just change depending on the flavor of the day in Parliament, depending on who the Prime Minister happens to be on any given day. People in Canada think too much in terms of political parties. I mean, look, for crying out loud, the party names are liberal and conservative. Whereas in the U.S., liberal and conservative are ways of life, not political parties. Democrat and Republican are parties. So many people, especially the left, they have a big issue with this. They can't separate someone from saying, I am a conservative, to someone saying, I am a Conservative Party supporter. I've had myriad decisions that Stephen Harper has done, that the Conservatives have done, that I've disagreed with, and I'll say, oh, I'm a Conservative, and they'll be, oh, so you must agree with this. No, actually. You know, unlike the left, I don't believe in blind acceptance of party doctrine. I believe in conservative values. And I think when you boil it down, a lot of Canadians do. Even Canadians that don't, on paper, and don't have a sign on their lawn for the Conservative Party of Canada candidate in their riding. I think most Canadians have conservative values when you look at fiscal issues, at least. Social issues are a little bit different, and I'm going to be talking a bit more about that later on, discussing the Supreme Court ruling in the U.S. on same-sex marriage. But I think a lot of people, especially new Canadians, want many of the things for which I tirelessly advocate. Things like less government intrusion in their lives. Things like more economic freedom. Things like lower taxes. The problem is the culture itself in Canada is one that has convinced people they don't have an option. It's one that has convinced people there's no other choice. There's no other course of action. There's no way around socialism. And that's troubling. And that's what I think, if anything else, we need to be thinking about on Canada Day. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying you can't have your barbecue and your fireworks. Go wild. Do that. Celebrate this country. There's a lot to be celebrated. But let's also not delude ourselves into thinking that there's nothing we need. Because there is. We need to, in order to have a true level of pride in the country in which we live, for me, in which I was born and raised, we all need to be able to look at our own flaws, look through introspection and say, okay, there are some things that need to change. And I realize this is a big concept. And this isn't even an overnight call to action. I don't expect people to listen to this and be like, you know what? I'm going to make the change tomorrow, because you can't. This is a change that takes generations. At the very least, a generation. And if you don't believe me, we can, to be honest, actually look at the things that have screwed over our country as examples of how change can be enacted. Look at the eradication of the word dominion from our identity in a generation. What makes you think in a generation we couldn't bring it back? Look at so many things in this country that are different now than they were 25, 30, 35 years ago. These are things that can change back. We need to change the battle in culture, not in politics. And this speaks to a broader theme, not only on this show, but in my life in general, which is this belief that we need to be waging wars, metaphorically, of course, in schools, on the airwaves, on TV, etc., rather than at the ballot box. We need to do that as well, but that really only supplements the bigger changes that are needed. Because, look, there is not at all a generational focus, a multi-generational focus by government. There isn't. Every now and then the left will say there is when they're talking about global warming and environmentalism, but all they're doing is trying to get fundraising dollars and get reelected anyway. There's not, in my eyes anyway, a large attitude in government of our leaders looking 25 years down the road and saying, yes, I'm working for them. That needs to come from you. That needs to come from parents and grandparents. That needs to come from teachers and, dare I say, professors. It needs to come from podcasters. So I have some work to do in this as well. But to me, when I was sitting around earlier today on Canada Day, just thinking about this country, I was grateful. And I am grateful for this country. I believe there is the potential for exceptionalism in Canada, but not without conditions, not without a greater sense of support across the board for the values that I've just been discussing, the values that I talk about every week on the show. And they're not controversial things. Freedom is not controversial. It's been painted as such. But if you talk one-on-one to the average person, smart people, not your Naomi Klein types, you'll find that they genuinely agree. People believe freedom. They don't understand it. You know, there was a great clip from The West Wing. A little bit of a spoiler alert, but it's not integral to the plot of the show. There was a North Korean pianist that was performing at the White House, escorted by North Korean guards under very tight watch, and he gave the president a signed CD. He didn't sign it before he gave it to him, though. He said, wait, I will sign it. He goes over to the CD, away from the watchful eyes of his guards for just a moment, and writes inside the cover, I wish to defect. Now, the president was dealing with something at the time, wanting to make a deal with North Korea if he accepted the defection, which by law he would have had to. It would have jeopardized the diplomatic relations that Martin Sheen's character was trying to do with North Korea. So what he did is he instead put it to the pianist, and he said, I can't tell you to do this, but if you do it, we have to accept you. And he's basically saying, look, I'm not going to help you along, but you have this choice. And he didn't make the choice. Because what ended up happening is something that was relayed by the president later on in the episode. He said he didn't understand what it meant to have a choice. Now, yes, that's a dramatized example of it, but I think this is, albeit in a more heightened way, what a lot of Canadians are dealing with. We don't know we have an option. Our own inferiority complex, I think, in many areas has led us to believe that everything is unchangeable, that the status quo may never be tipped. I'm proud to be a Canadian. I love Canada. I want to see Canada prosper, and change needs to happen for that to happen in a long-term sense. But to all of you, happy belated Dominion Day. I'm Andrew Lawton. This is Lawton Online. We'll be right back in just a couple of moments. Stay tuned.
Listening to Lawton Online with your host, Andrew Lawton, exclusively on TheRebel.media.
Welcome back to Lawton Online here on TheRebel.media. You know, we have to celebrate a couple of things on the show today. Not only are we celebrating Canada Day, or as I prefer to refer to it as Dominion Day, but we also have to celebrate true love. You know that sentiment, that feeling, that overwhelming sensation that is said to conquer all. And it's something that Luka Magnotta, yes, Luka Magnotta, that one, is looking for. Yes, you may have heard by now, Luka Magnotta, the man who just in December, 6 months ago, was convicted of the murder of Jun Lin, a Chinese national, after which he cannibalized him, decapitated him, dismembered him, sent his body parts all around the country, including to the Prime Minister, or to the headquarters of the Conservative Party of Canada. He is looking for romance. And he's actually joined a dating website specifically for those that would like to engage in a post-sentence relationship or a pen pal relationship with members of Canada's prison population. The website is called CanadianInmatesConnect.com. And yes, if you thought you'd heard it all, this is a real thing. Or as I said in a piece I wrote on AM980.ca this week, it was Luka Magnotta looking for love in confined places. It's kind of laughable, actually. I mean, if it weren't so scary. A self-described Prince Charming might be looking for you. He's 33, 5'11", 175 pounds. I noted he's got the wavy dark hair of Leonardo DiCaprio and the piercing blue eyes of Brad Pitt. He's on the market, but there's a catch. His name is Luka Magnotta. Yes, 6 months after being convicted of first-degree murder for the June 2012 killing and dismemberment of Jun Lin, the Scarborough-born Magnotta is seeking a new companion. His dating profile is saying that he's looking for a single white male, so he's racist, too. This is just terrible. 28 to 38 years of age, white and in shape. Beauty's only skin deep, though. You see, Magnotta also wants, laughably, someone who is loyal, educated, and financially and emotionally stable. Because, yes, emotional stability describes anyone that would want to be in a relationship with Luka Magnotta. At least someone will be, I guess. He's inviting people to write him at his facility at Archambault Penitentiary in Quebec. Yes, I think everyone should write him and tell him exactly how you feel about him. The owner of the site, a woman by the name of Melissa Fazina, said everyone deserves the opportunity to redeem themselves. She says that includes the chance of love. Maybe he's just looking for a long-term committed partner. He paid $35 to be on the site. He submitted his profile, which he wrote himself, by mail. He's even getting a little bit choosy. He said, only those I deem compatible will receive a response. Serious inquiries only. Now, I want to talk in a little bit about the implications here of prisoners being able to basically try to meet someone and move on from their life while they're still behind bars. Now, I'll talk about that very shortly, but I wanted to give a little bit of a public service announcement because I get that Magnotta is probably one of the most famous people, if not the most famous people, on this website. And I think this is concerning because he's being selective. He can only find one true love for when he, in his eyes, is released in 2037. Yeah, he's put down his parole eligibility date as his actual release date. He also didn't specify what he was convicted of, which would, you know, perhaps put a damper on his love life. But just in case you write a letter to him and you don't get a response, I want you to know that there are other options out there. There are other Canadian inmates looking for your love. For example, Michael Story at the North Fraser pretrial institution. He's fighting a second-degree murder charge. Says it's a misunderstanding at this time. He doesn't know when he'll get out. He's interested in women. Do you like bad boys, he writes. Ladies, I'm not just your average rebel without a cause. I'm much more. I'm a rebel with a cause. That is much more. Fitness, weights, and mixed martial arts are part of my daily routine. I also enjoy feeling and looking great, as well as eating healthy and organic, if possible. even the hardened second-degree murderers in BC are eating organic now. That's how bad things are. Shay O'Leary, the Donnacona Penitentiary, he's convicted of drug and gun possession. He expects to be released within the next few years. 25 years old, strapping gentleman. He's originally from Nova Scotia. Well, that explains it. He's into fitness, sports, boxing, and weight training. He's ambitious, easygoing, and confident. His sentence was for 11 years. He's a vegetarian, a great cook, and a good listener. He returns all letters. He's not too sure what he's looking for, but he says he's open to new things. John Breen at Fenbrook Penitentiary in Gravenhurst. He's also in for second-degree murder. Interested in women. He's been in prison for 21 years, but he likes music. He's developed an eclectic taste, he says. He takes pleasure in learning, playing guitar, and he doesn't say it, but I think it might be shanking people in the yard as well. He says he's a Catholic, so you never know. No sex before marriage, but he might kill you. Kevin Perez, also at Donnacona Penitentiary in Quebec, he's in for second-degree murder, which appears to be, I guess, what they're all in for that are on this site anyway. He says he's looking for women of all shapes and sizes, older women too. He's single with no children, but he does want a family of his own. He's completed grade 12 and is looking forward to continuing his schooling. His hobbies include playing chess, basketball, writing lyrics, working out, and reading novels. He doesn't like disloyalty, lies, or immaturity, and well, we know what happens when something happens that he doesn't like. Oh, what else do we have here? Who else is looking for love? Travis Burnett is. He's at Edmonton Maximum Penitentiary. He's also in for, you guessed it, second-degree murder. But he's an easygoing Métis guy, Calgary-born and raised. He's respectful, easygoing, and friendly. He's always well-dressed, and he's got one tattoo. He's 8 years into a 17-year sentence. He used to be a real bad boy, but now he's experienced enough life to be a really good man, he says. If his intro piques your curiosity, he's only a pen, a paper, and a stamped envelope away to see what opportunities present themselves. These men deserve love. No, they don't. They're scum. They're absolute human scum. And I believe that people can change. I believe that people can transform. But I also believe in so many ways, especially when you look at a case like this, that we should not be operating on the assumption that they are not. I don't think that people in prison should be completely cut off from their friends and their families and other loved ones, but I think they should be cut off from making new friends. developing new experiences. I mean, let's take something into consideration here. It's one thing if you're, you know, corresponding with someone or you meet someone on a date and you find out later on that they happen to have been a murderer. All right. I would still question your judgment if you wanted to continue to go out with them. But, you know, at least you could say, well, you know what? We had lots in common and I learned that after the fact. And by then I had already fallen in love with him or her. Okay. True Hollywood romance there. That's the stuff Taylor Swift sings about. But this is something different. This is someone going out of their way to go onto a website exclusively dedicated to, not ex-cons, cons, to people who are presently serving sentences. And you expect me to believe that this is somehow a right that we need to have in those who are residents of the Correction Services of Canada? What kind of person is reaching out to Luka Magnotta saying, hey, I want to explore a relationship with you because there's three reasons. Number one, they don't believe he's guilty, even though he admitted to it. Number two, they believe it but think people overreacted. Number three, they believe it and don't care. They believe it and are happy with that and don't mind that and are actually, for whatever sick reason, attracted to that. Now, Stephen Blaney, Canada's Minister of Public Safety, has called this website, through a spokesperson anyway, despicable. Speaking out against it, saying, you know what, there's really no place for this. And the minister has actually called on CSC to review procedures and the policies surrounding convicts being able to send and receive mail. And I think that's an important step because, well, for starters, there are huge implications if these people are making friends with people, making contacts and connections with people who are only interested in them because of their criminal status. Like I said, when your predominant attraction and your only knowledge of someone before you send them a letter is, hey, you're in prison for second-degree murder, or first-degree in the case of Luka Magnotta, although he says not stated, so maybe he's thinking people will assume it's like a parking ticket or something, I don't know. When you're using that as the basis for a relationship. You know, I get that, you know, honesty and trust are the cornerstone of any healthy relationship, but maybe not bonding over murder. Maybe I'm old-fashioned, but maybe not having a shared experience over a support of someone's murder. And I get that it's tough. And to be honest, I understand and accept and agree with the notion that prison has to be, at least in some form, rehabilitative as opposed to simply punitive. And I know that may be an unpopular concept, especially among a lot of conservatives. But the fact is, not every sentence that's discharged in the Canadian legal system is a life sentence. And even the ones who do get life are often paroled after 25 years or more. And that means that we need to be keeping in mind the reintegration back into the real world for people that are in prison. Now, people like Magnotta, I doubt will ever see the light of day. Same as people like Paul Bernardo, people like Michael Rafferty. I assume that these people won't. And there are other people that will. Now, and when you are ready to go back into the real world, whether because of the expiration of your sentence or because you have sought parole, I believe that the prison should equip you for that moment when it happens. If that means letting you pursue your education, I support that. Pursuing an apprenticeship, I support that. It's expensive, but I think it benefits everyone in Canada in the long run. At the same time, I don't believe that you should be given privileges that will not help society. And Luka Magnotta meeting some fanboy in the general population that is enamored with his murderous past, that does not sound like something that benefits anyone except for Magnotta's ego. And what's interesting about this story is that a lot of people have spoken out to media, and I've received myriad criticisms about this. Why are you drawing attention? Why are you talking about it? Why are you bringing more attention to this guy who clearly craves it? Well, because drawing attention to stories like this is the only way to really get change to happen. And look what's happened in 24 hours since this story broke. The minister has already pledged to look into it. I have to question seriously what's wrong with the woman behind the site. I don't know anything about her personally. I don't know if she herself fell in love with a convict. Maybe she's an ex-convict. I look, just for the heck of it, at the females on the site. Unfortunately, there's only one. I feel bad because, you know what, I'm sure there are lots of female inmates that are, you know, totally down to meet someone new when they came out. Or maybe they're actually, taking the time to devote it a little bit more to their own penance. The one woman who is there, for those interested, is in Edmonton. Her name's Deborah Lobb. She's in for aggravated assault. She's interested in pen pals or relationships. She looks a bit tough, to say the least, but you know what? She's on her way out in July, so good on her. But frankly, I don't get what it would be about someone that, as a primary point of attraction, would drive them to want to be with a convict. To each their own. I get it. Everyone has their own attractions, their own orientations. Everyone has their own fetishes. I'm sure Omar Khadr has a few fangirls and boys out there. You never know. I'm not here to judge, right? And in the U.S., it's legal, too, so I really can't judge. But here's the interesting thing. I think it's interesting anyway. At what point do we draw the line on where your life is supposed to stop when you're behind bars? And you'll have to pick up when you leave. Because I think making new relationships is one of those things. Sure, once you are out of the jail, if you want to make a relationship, absolutely. If you want to make a relationship with one of your fellow inmates, hey, go wild. That's what the showers are for, and I hope they have liquid soap. But I frankly don't buy this notion that we need to be allowing them to receive fan mail. Because several media reports have pointed to this. To Magnotta, even before his dating ad went up this week, to be receiving fan mail from complete strangers. If you take into consideration someone else in the jail or prison who might have an organized crime connection, can we start to see the problems of maybe them being connected with people that they shouldn't be connected with, given why they're in there in the first place? I cannot think of one single good thing that could come. Well, I'm sure if you really, really racked your brain, you could come up with something, but no reasonable good thing that could come from a stranger emailing a convicted murderer. Friends and family, sure, absolutely. You should be lucky you're even getting that if any of them want to speak to you. But you don't deserve to find love as part of your second chance until you're out the door. We got to take a break here. When we come back, more Lawton Online on TheRebel.media. I'm Andrew Lawton. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
He's unapologetic, unwavering, and unafraid to take on the left's sacred cows. He's Andrew Lawton, and you're listening to Lawton Online on TheRebel.media.
Welcome back to Lawton Online. One major recurring theme you'll have heard if you've listened to even a couple episodes of this program is a rather stark fondness that I have that is not necessarily rooted in, well, many areas of life, education, parenting, etc. And that is a desire to seek personal responsibility, not only for my own actions, but in general. I think people need to do this. And I think the problem is not one that we can simply boil down to liberalism. I think it's one that we have to look at as more of a cultural problem than a political problem. Cultural Marxism, absolutely, which is nothing but a wing of liberalism, has contributed to this. Specifically, though, it starts with children and robbing them of any semblance of merit, which has implications that extend far, far along in life. Like in school, like in work, like in the real world, where now people are increasingly sheltered from its terrible, offensive, politically incorrect nature. Or, as I call it, again, reality. Margaret Wente, the Globe and Mail columnist, had a fascinating column about this last weekend that is unsurprising, but still very, very pertinent and timely. And she writes about the snowflake generation, a term I've used myself, and she specifically looks at it in the terms of rewarding kids for just showing up, basically. She talks about a friend of hers whose five-year-old had a graduation from daycare of some kind or nursery school, whatever it was, and got, you know, cap and gown and tassels and diplomas. And she says by the time someone's 18 years old, they're going to have awards coming out the yin yang and not really for any accomplishment, just for showing up. Had the opportunity to speak with Margaret about this column and the issue in general on my radio show on London's AM 980 this week. And I wanted to share that interview with you here. Margaret, it's great to talk to you. I really appreciate your time today.
Hi, Andrew.
And so first off, did you even know that this was a thing, graduation ceremonies for nursery schools?
I had no idea it was a thing, but obviously I am dated. It shows how dated I am.
It's one of these things where, I mean, obviously, even saying colloquially, okay, yes, he graduated from nursing school or nursery, or she graduated, is one thing. But the actual ceremony itself, that to me seems to be the sticking point here.
Yeah, it's the whole deal. The kid has a mortarboard on his head. He has a tiny little diploma in his hand. And they do this for every grade now, as far as I know. You know, when I was a kid, it was just, you know, a couple times, grade 8, high school, that was it. But now it's every year. The kids don't just pass their year, they graduate. And they all get a huge pat on the back from their parents. And all the parents show up. All the grandparents show up.
And what's interesting here, and I think you touch on the bigger issue with this and why it's not just some little quirk that happens that we can sort of roll our eyes and laugh off, because you say, quote, by the time a kid reaches 18, she will have accumulated boxes and boxes of diplomas, medals, ribbons, trophies, and certificates just for showing up, whether she's good at anything or not, unquote. And the reason I think that's so incredibly important here is because you can delay it as long as you want. I mean, even if someone goes to university for 10 years after high school, at some point they're going to have to get to the real world where effort is not everything.
Well, and the other blow is they're going to find out that in the real world, they're not special.
Yes.
And, of course, that's what they've been told all their lives. They are special. They are unique little human beings with unique set of gifts and talents, and the world is just waiting for them to go and fulfill their dreams. And guess what? The world isn't.
Yeah, and it's actually quite interesting because I was looking up just some other things connected to this issue, knowing I was going to be speaking to you today, and I came across a piece. I don't know if you've seen it. It was on a personal blog, actually, just the other day, stuartsheldon.com. He writes, "My kid's not a winner, so stop with the trophies." And he's talking about this very thing, which he's saying, look, he loves his son, he loves his five-year-old, but he said in some choice words that I won't repeat on the airwaves for the risk of losing the broadcast license, that it was simply BS, that there was this, you know, cap and gown ceremony for a five-year-old, complete with a diploma and a graduation. But what's interesting, though, is that he quotes a professor, a psychologist with Miami-Dade County Public Schools, who says, quote, "When we try to make each child feel like a winner in some way or in some way outstanding, even if the student has done little to warrant such attention, that's all we're doing, is we're drawing attention to absolutely nothing."
Yes, and, you know, that's unfortunately the case. And then people either devalue it or the kid gets – what the thing that bothers me is what happens to the kid when he encounters the real world and people aren't giving him prizes anymore. It could be a real blow. It could be quite awful to make the adjustment. And the other thing that really surprised me when I was thinking about this story and talking to people about it is how long, the extent to which parents stay involved in their children's lives now, not just when they're little and not just when they're in high school, but when they're in university and even when they're moving out into the job market. The parents are always there, yeah, trying to make sure the kid doesn't fail.
I used to work in it was in a retail environment years ago, and I remember someone, you know, coming in. Actually, it happened on at least two or three occasions. A parent accompanying a teen to drop off a resume.
Oh, that's nothing.
Yeah, I know. And this is the worst thing is that at the time I thought that was so incredibly just unbelievable, and now apparently that's the least of the troubles.
How about a parent calling a manager to say that the kid's performance review wasn't fair?
This has not actually happened, has it?
It has actually happened.
Oh, my goodness.
I talked to the person who got the call from the mom.
When did this happen? I mean, you said this wasn't around, as to your recollection, you know, going back to, you know, when you were in school. So can we pinpoint, like, one moment at which we all went off the rails here?
No, I think it's just a product of hyper-parenting, the hyper-parenting age. And I think a huge factor, actually, is modern communications, because parents can keep in constant touch with their kids. And, you know, many kids and parents that I know, you know, they'll text back and forth 20 times a day. They know exactly what's going on with each other's lives. Doesn't matter how old the kid is. Kid can be 25. But, you know, they're still texting back and forth, usually with mom, to fill her in on absolutely everything that's happening. Now, Andrew, I don't know how old you are, but basically I barely talked to my parents after I went away to university.
Well, and I think there's a difference between keeping in touch, you know, the cursory drop-ins and the checkups one. But it's quite another when you're talking about the sort of, you know, the girl talk or the, you know, the guy talk that you'd have with your friends when you're filling them into that level of detail. That's where it seems to be especially concerning.
It does happen. You know, there's such a thing as too much information. And I think a lot of parents have too much information about their kids' lives, you know, their semi-adult kids' lives. And it just makes it harder for the child to separate from the parent and go out and be on his own, take his lumps and have to make his decisions and cope with his own failures or his own lousy performance review.
And one line that really stands out in your column here, you say near the end, you know, reality will bite soon enough. And I think this is the interesting thing here is that we haven't gotten to the point yet. And I fear that it may be, you know, a couple of years away, but let's not put the cart before the horse here. We haven't gotten to the point where you can completely be coddled from cradle to grave in terms of being, you know, protected from heartache or protected from the realization that you're not that special. And so I think it's interesting. We're seeing so many people that are literally, and I think this is contributing to it, you know, the proverbial, you know, master's graduate that's trying to get a job at a fast food restaurant. I mean, these people, they're holding out for the dream instead of facing reality.
Well, we've told our kids all their lives, do what you dream, dream your dream and then go do it. And, you know, that's very inspirational, but it's not very realistic for kids who may be unfortunately just average. And it shuts them out from a lot of possibilities that they should be considering and that they might find really, really rewarding. You know, a job recruiter friend of mine said, you know, there are a lot of great jobs in insurance, but no one ever says to a kid, oh, you could get a great job in insurance. You know, they're dreaming about saving the third world or saving the environment. And they miss out on a lot of possibilities and they get really frustrated.
Yeah, and what I find to be really, really unfortunate, I mean, I've seen this as well, and this is not a new phenomenon, but the helicopter parenting that seems to try to be there, like we were talking about earlier, through absolutely everything. And what's interesting is there's one person I know who, I mean, basically was one of these people raised by one of these parents that would always be there. Oh, you know, you got a bad grade in school. Okay, the parent's there. Okay, you know, someone said something to you. All right, the parent's there. And what's interesting is I looked this person up, you know, this is a few years ago now, and didn't really seem like they had done much with their life anyway. And I mean, that was sort of a cursory, you know, like taking advantage of being able to look someone up on Facebook, you know, years after the fact. But it seems like this is really what we're creating in people. It's this culture of waiters. I mean, people that are just waiting around because they feel that, you know, they are special enough and the world is going to land on their lap. And some people get lucky, but it doesn't really seem to work that way.
Well, you're right. And, you know, what you want to develop in a kid the most, I think, is resilience. The ability to pick yourself up, brush yourself up off, move along, look for opportunities, seize what's there, and make the best of it. You know, the fact is, even in your 20s, you know, life isn't all that great. You know, you're not going to get the job of your dreams in your 20s. You're going to get some crummy job, kind of the equivalent of sweeping floors and pouring people's coffee, and, you know, you'll work your way up. That's still the way the world works. And, you know, if kids don't know that, then they're going to be terribly disappointed and jolted by it.
Yes, and the thing is, I mean, the snowflake analogy is one that I think people like you and I sort of use it in mocking terminology, but that's really been, you know, the attitude between a lot of the people that are pushing for what we're speaking out against, which is, you know, you're unique, you're special, you know, no two are made the same way. But you point out a painfully obvious observation about snowflakes that I've never really noted before in your column.
Well, you know, when they hit the pavement, they melt.
I mean, it's so true. I mean, if you're going to commit to a metaphor, you have to see it through.
Right. So, you know, it's not a bad thing to build a bit of resilience into your kids and to stay hands off sometimes, even when you see them falling down and scraping their knee or, you know, getting a bad performance review.
Yeah, and this is where I think it's been really fascinating to watch this unfold, because I don't have children, but a lot of parents that I know are doing exactly this, but they're forgetting that they didn't need that growing up.
Well, they didn't get it. Probably,
yeah.
They didn't get it. You know, our parents had a lot more kids to worry about anyway, so they worried less about each one of us.
Yeah, they just got the kids to look after each other.
It's natural for parents to worry about their kids. And I think now that parents are having fewer children, they're investing more in each child. Also, there's a tremendous tendency these days for parents to identify with the success of their children so strongly that if their kid isn't succeeding, they feel like they're not succeeding and they've really gone wrong somewhere.
So if you could write a guide for would-be parents, where would you suggest that balance can be found? I mean, where's the point where, okay, this is a healthy level of support and being there and praise, but not the overkill that we're discussing?
Well, yeah, I mean, you're going to jump in and help your kid if he or she runs into serious problems. But at a certain point, you know, as the child gets older, you have to say, all right, this is a young adult in the making. She or he will have to make his or her own mistakes. I'll be sympathetic. But good Lord, at a certain point, I'm not going to bail them out.
Yeah, it's the same as, you know, parents of very young children. I mean, you have to teach your kids to literally just stop crying and get up off the ground when they fall instead of rushing to them and, you know, holding their hands at a certain age.
That's right. And, you know, our culture, it's very interesting because this is very, very culturally determined. Other cultures don't do that at all. They let the kid fall down, or if the kid's having a temper tantrum in the street, they say, okay, well, that's your business. And, you know, they just don't put up with it.
And yeah,
the children behave a lot differently.
Yeah, it's one of the things in which, you know, for all our developments and advances in society, we've really seemed to have gone backwards on.
Well,
anyway, fascinating and wonderfully written column, Margaret. So I really appreciate your time today.
Thanks very much, Andrew.
On the outside, I'm laughing, but I can assure you, on the inside, I'm crying. Absolutely ridiculous, but herein lies the world in which we live. We've got to take a quick break here, but I would welcome your stories on this because I know when I did the show on my or did the topic on my radio show, I got feedback from so many parents who are like, "Yep, been there. I agree with you." Yet still, we have enough parents that are coming at it from the other side of the spectrum who clearly don't agree and think that there is a benefit to this coddling, to this helicoptering. So I don't know. Remind me that there are still good parents out there. Please let me know. Andrew@andrewlawton.ca is my email address. More of Lawton Online coming up in just a few moments here on TheRebel.media. Stay with us.
You're listening to Lawton Online with your host, Andrew Lawton, exclusively on TheRebel.media. Email your thoughts to Andrew at andrewlawton.ca or tweet Andrew using @AndrewLawton.
Hey, and welcome back to Lawton Online. So glad you're sticking with me through the show anyway. Well, those who are hearing this have anyway. So, okay, I got to break with tradition a little bit here and do something that I, generally speaking, am against doing, and that's talking about sports. Look, I'm not a huge sports fan. I'm not against sports. I just don't understand them. I've never been particularly good at them. You'll never catch me watching a hockey game. Maybe I watch the opening ceremonies for the Olympics, but none of the actual events. I watch the Super Bowl, but that's more for the food. And, well, you get the gist. Sports, not my cup of tea. And that's fine. I get excited and riled up about election debates and polls coming in. So everyone's got their own little things that they pay attention to. So this will be one of few, if any, occasions where I will actually talk about, on this show, here on Lawton Online, unfiltered sports. Now, in this case, I'm talking about baseball, which apparently isn't, in fact, a real sport still, and an event being held in Victoria, B.C., over which feminists are apparently crying foul, which I believe is a baseball pun, if I'm not mistaken, because they don't like a contest that was held for women who are attending the amateur baseball games in which the Frisco Rough Riders are playing in Victoria. It's called a diamond dig, and it is, as the name would suggest, a contest in which women are selected from the fans at the game, and they're invited to dig through piles of dirt with nothing but a plastic spoon to find a ring box. If they find the ring box that has a ring inside it, they win $1,000 at Barclays Jewelers. Now, as you can imagine, this has ignited a firestorm of people that claim that it's offensive, that it's demeaning
that it's degrading to women. Now, I don't understand any of these arguments. All I understand are that there are a bunch of people that spare no time in whining about absolutely anything, probably because these women are upset that no man has given them jewelry in a while. If anything, I would be offended that this diamond dig is sexist and that it's not inviting men to participate. But no, it's funny. If you look at the pictures of this, there are at least a dozen women on their hands and knees on the ground digging through the dirt. So clearly they are okay with this. Clearly the women who are said to be demeaned by this event are okay with it. Maybe they have no self-respect. I don't know them. If so, who cares? They're still making that choice. Now, the general manager of the Harbor Cats has basically said, we're not actually used to getting issues with this. He doesn't care. He said it's going on. He said it's participatory. People can take part in it or not. It's up to them. He said they're all fun and tongue-in-cheek. He said he knows his wife would go in, but she's a team employee, so she can't. This is not a new contest. Other baseball games have done this, and he said he's never heard of a complaint about it. A political science professor and self-described feminist at University of Victoria was one of the women calling out this event. Jani Aragon, saying that she was, quote, shocked to hear about it. She said, this is what feminists love to say. I don't think it's particularly funny, and I have a really good sense of humor. No, you don't. But she said, but talk about playing with the gold digger trope. Well, first off, it's not gold, it's a diamond, so ha. And secondly, she said it reinforces the, quote, stereotype of women being obsessed with gold or jewelry. Now, as someone who is in a committed relationship, I can say that I don't think this is an offensive stereotype. I also don't think it's an incorrect stereotype. I mean, obsessed or not, I don't think it's a stretch to say that women like jewelry. I don't think it's a stretch to say that women enjoy jewelry. I don't think it's a stretch to say that some women would love it if someone said, hey, here's $1,000 at a jeweler store. So I don't get how that gets transitioned somehow in some convoluted way to something that demeans women. But a UBC professor, Annette Henry, also a feminist, said it's demeaning. She said, this doesn't feel good to me and shows me that we haven't moved that far. It puts women in a box where they'll do anything for a piece of jewelry. Not anything. It's just digging through dirt with a plastic spoon. Come on. She says that she doesn't like the language used to promote the event because it says, quote, let them loose. She said the intention is fun, but she hopes that there are going to be discussions after this about whether future events will be promoted like this or whether or not they will actually change them. It's this ongoing knee-jerk culture and reactionism that comes only from the left, only from academia, only from feminism, only from these organizations, all of them or any one of them as individuals. Because you know what? After all, a contest is now subject to this. I feel so bad, and I can't stress this enough. I feel so bad for corporate marketing executives. Corporate marketing executives who now have to come up not only with good ideas for low pay at the snap of one's fingers, but have to navigate this world as well, where every contest, every ad campaign, every strategy, every 30-minute spot you do, every radio ad, every billboard, every bus shelter ad, every bus ad is now going to be by someone somewhere deemed to be offensive and then unleash a ticking time bomb as to when the company itself caves and throws you under the bus for something that everyone in the boardroom thought was funny. Now, obviously, in this case, we're not looking at a high-powered, highly funded boardroom here. We're looking at an amateur baseball team that does something that lots of other baseball teams I've read do. But we're still looking at, like any other organization, a group that's trying to reinvent itself, trying to modernize, trying to have fun, trying to come up with ways that it can get people engaged. And you know what? From everything that I know, it's hard to get women out to sporting events. So stuff like this makes them feel, hey, they're looking out for us fans as well, and we make up whatever percentage of their ticket sales. So I don't know why anyone is justified in trying to shut an event like this down. Now, to be clear, and to the credit of the detractors from this, I haven't seen any, you know, big giant petitions trying to have them boycotted or banned or anything. In fact, one of the professors specifically said she wasn't going to boycott nor girlcott. That's what she said. So I'm happy about that. But at the same time, I also think here that we need to recognize that if we let even one of these things topple, let even one of these things fall and cave into those who are offended, we are forever going to sacrifice our high ground on any issue. We are always, always, always going to lose. Because the people who are advocating for so-called change, the people who are claiming offense, calling out things for being offensive, politically incorrect, demeaning, degrading, sexist, homophobic, racist, bigoted, transphobic, all of these people, they're never going to be satisfied. They're never going to be satisfied with anything, especially when you're dealing with the radical feminists. I mean, these are people who are never going to be happy about any of these issues. All you're doing is losing your own ability, first off, to at least say that you have principles, which is why I really respect the team for not caving in, because lots of bigger companies would. Oh, there have been tons of ad campaigns, even in the last few months. Bud Light had one where they've backtracked on things because a couple of people got offended. A bus company in Wales had an ad that they backtracked on. I don't think I talked about it here on the podcast, but it was a bus ad that had a picture of a scantily clad man or a scantily clad woman, depending on the bus, and a sign that says, "Ride me all day for £3. Referring, of course, to the actual bus itself. And people saw that one was offensive, so the bus company had to pull it. And it goes on and on and on without any sense of reprieve. And this is something against which all of us need to fight back. Because the second you don't, it happens to you. We've got to take a break here. When we come back, more Lawton Online on TheRebel.media. Got a bit of a final wrap-up before we bid farewell. That's coming up in just a couple of moments. I'm Andrew Lawton. Stay tuned.
It's time for It Must Be a Liberal, only on Lawton Online. Scouring every corner of the globe for stories so outrageous, there must be a liberal involved.
Welcome back. Yes, you heard the man. It's time for It Must Be a Liberal here on Lawton Online, scouring every corner of the globe from Winnipeg to Wichita and finding the story so outrageous, there must be a liberal involved. And today we actually go to a state I've been to, which is Washington, although I've never been to Spokane where this happened. Although Spokane, the site of Rachel Dolezal's, little fake foray into race relations advocacy. Clearly some stuff happens there that is worthy of It Must Be a Liberal. Our candidate today is not Miss Dolezal, but a man named Thomas Cammers. 42 years old, he was arrested by a Spokane County sheriff when he was driving around with a suspended license. The sheriff saw a bag of white crystals in the car that looked like it was meth. He was driving a 1992 Honda, which in and of itself I think is a cause for concern, with expired plates. The deputy had stopped the car. They asked him about the meth, and he said, "To be honest, officer, it's fake meth." He said that just like alcoholics sometimes drink non-alcoholic beer just for the taste and not the high that comes from drinking it, he said that he's doing it because he's a meth addict. He wants the fake meth just for the fake high. It's fake, he said. Not buying it, the officer, a little bit skeptical, had to test it, and as it turns out, it was actually real meth. But you know what? You can't blame a guy for trying. But I think it's safe to say that when you're caught driving around, clearly looking like you're drugged out of your mind, and you have the gall to tell a police officer that the meth you are smoking is fake, well, I think it's safe to say you must be a liberal. There's really no other option. Ladies and gentlemen, thanks so much for tuning in today. Lawton Online returns next week on TheRebel.media. I'm Andrew Lawton. Thanks so much.
Thanks for tuning in to Lawton Online. Check out TheRebel.media for lots more fearless content and commentary.